Welcome to Successful Philanthropy. I'm your host, Jean Shafiroff, and this show is designed to highlight the work of philanthropic leaders here in the United States and then beyond. With us, a very special man. His name, Peter Michalos, MD. Peter is based in Southampton, New York. He is the founder and chairman of Hamptons Health Society, a group that has supplied countless ventilators, masks, and all sorts of materials to COVID-19 pandemic workers here on the eastern end of Long Island. Let's all welcome Dr. Peter Michalos. And Peter, it is so nice to have you joining us today. And before I start and talk about all you've done for the Hamptons, I want you to give us a little bit of background on who you are and what some of your affiliations are. I understand you're affiliated with Columbia Presbyterian, but I want to hear in your words.
Yes, I've been in Southampton since 1991 when I finished my fellowship at Columbia Presbyterian in orbital and oculoplastic surgery after my ophthalmology residency. And prior to that, my internship at New York Hospital Cornell Medical Center. And I've been a clinical associate professor of ophthalmology and orbit and oculoplastic surgery at Columbia Presbyterian. I came out to Southampton because I wanted to raise my family here. And I continue to be on the honorary staff of Southampton and continue to support the hospital and healthcare in general on the East End of Long Island.
Wonderful. And now, you've been very involved in raising funds, especially during this COVID-19 pandemic, for Stony Brook Southampton Hospital and other healthcare institutions here on the eastern end of Long Island. Do you want to talk a little bit about that and tell us how much you've raised exactly and what that money has gone towards?
Well, a lot of what we raise, sometimes the equipment is actually valued a lot more. For example, a few years ago, when the ICU beds were quite old in the hospital, I worked out a deal and found 10 demo beds, and I paid $37,000. If I bought them new, they would have been $30,000 each. So the actual amount of money doesn't always reflect. So we're able to find deals, we find demo beds, we find equipment, and for end of the year sales. So we get a lot more with our laser targeted philanthropy. And a lot of our donors are very smart business people, and they like to see where the money's going. So what we do is we find out from the doctors, we have a committee of physicians. We ask them, what do we need? For example, when we needed 68 new hospital beds, we worked out a deal, negotiated that. We show the invoice to our donors and say, this is what we're buying today. And for example, when during the crisis back in January, I started ordering ventilators on January 26th, and we showed the invoices to our donors, and they saw what we were doing, why we were doing it, and that's how we raise our money and laser target the needs of the community.
Yes, and I understand you raised that money in January 2020 for the pandemic. Is that correct? And that those ventilators were given to Stony Brook Southampton Hospital?
Yes, they were. What happened was I went to the airport to pick up a speaker who was coming to speak at our church on religious freedom from the European Union. And when I went to the airport, I saw actually a flight coming from Asia, and the people coming off of the flight were all wearing masks. And I went into the restroom. I know what a person who's not feeling well looks like. And there were a bunch of people who were like sweating with fever, coughing, and they looked quite ill. And I actually held my breath. I walked out of the bathroom, and I knew and I had heard that there was a problem going on in overseas. And at that point, I just had I get these instinctive gut feelings that there's going to be a problem. I promptly picked up our guests. I got into the car and I started making phone calls to providers. I started ordering thousands of N95 masks. I ordered 12 ventilators, which were $37,000 each. They thought I was crazy when I asked them for it, but because I have bought from these companies before, not only for this, but I'm involved with other organizations where we raise money for missionary trips and we buy equipment for missionary trips. And I said, please, I'm giving you, here's the card, here's a deposit. So we started actually ordering back then. That's the reason why in Southampton, there were no issues with shortages of PPEs for any of the nurses, employees, ICU. I would make regular daily rounds and I would deliver N95 masks to the ICU, to the respiratory therapists, and various other divisions at the hospital, and local law enforcement and other health related areas and frontline providers. And we also were the ones who pushed for the first mask order in New York State, which was written by Mayor Jesse Warren. I know he took a lot of flack in the beginning, but it was at the Hamptons Health Society, because you can't put out a mask order and then not have masks to give out people. So when we approached them, we said, you need to do a mask order. Look what they're doing in South Korea and other places. We have a pandemic that's about to hit us. We didn't listen to the Surgeon General, the head of the AMA, who was saying you don't need to wear masks. And also Dr. Fauci on January 25th on the CATS roundtable said that this is nothing to worry about. And I didn't agree with that. And the Hamptons Health Society Committee of Physicians didn't agree with that. So we started getting all the masks in, and we started, you know, basically also handing them out to the public. Mayor Jesse Warren had a program where we would put 10 masks in a Ziploc baggie. People would drive up with their cars. We would attach them to their windshield wiper and they would drive off. And we did that throughout not only the village of Southampton, but we supplied it to all the towns on the east end of Long Island. And that, I think, helped immediately slow down the spread out here. We were very fortunate because the cases that presented out here were not from here.
Which is really wonderful. And I just want to say that as a member of the Southampton Hospital Association, a governing board of the Stony Brook Southampton Hospital, I, on behalf of the board and the hospital, we're very grateful to you and what you've done for the hospital in terms of supplies and everything else during this pandemic. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the pandemic and what's going on right now. We're in a situation where not everyone is vaccinated, and there are three available vaccines, the Johnson & Johnson available in a few places, the Pfizer, and then the Moderna. If it was up to you, which one would you take, and what do you recommend to people?
I would take whichever one was made available to you immediately, because this is a very serious disease. This is not the flu. There are over 508,000 people who have died in the United States, 2.5 million worldwide. So I wouldn't have a preference, and I think you should grab whatever one you can grab, because they've shown that all three vaccines, when taken, you will not die 99% of the time from COVID after you are immune, after your 2 weeks after your first shot with Johnson & Johnson, or the 2 weeks after your second shot with Pfizer or Moderna. There are differences with potential side effects. More people have complained about side effects with Moderna. That doesn't necessarily mean that it's any worse or any better. There are advantages to the Johnson & Johnson, of course, for the older population, the disabled, people who need rides, commuting, having a single shot. The fact that you don't require any specialized refrigeration as you do with the Pfizer and the Moderna, and you can keep it in a regular refrigerator and even store it for several days after, that is a tremendous advantage.
And then now, what about women who are of childbearing age and who maybe want to start a family? Do you think it's advisable for them to be vaccinated, or what are your thoughts exactly?
Well, the problem is with new vaccines, there's never been an mRNA vaccine before available to the public. So we don't really know, and we're going to be finding out a lot in the next 2 years. So there is no data, there is no peer-reviewed literature to, explain that to people. I know some people who are pregnant have chosen not to get vaccinated this time, but to stay isolated in their homes and just go for their regular medical appointments, and they're waiting to be vaccinated after they give birth. So there is no right answer, because we just don't know, just like we don't know how long immunity will last. When you get a measles vaccine, it could give you a lifetime of immunity. A tetanus shot can give you 10 years of immunity. A flu shot might give you 8 to 12 months of immunity. But with mRNA vaccines, we actually have no idea. And I think part of our annual physical is going to be antibody titers. In about 6 months after you get a vaccine, a lot of people are going to want to travel, and they're going to wonder, do I actually have antibodies? Do I have immunity? So we're going to have part of our annual physical antibody titers. And I also think many countries around the world will require either evidence of antibodies through a blood test or a vaccination card as part of your travel. And also, people who do get vaccinated, please take a picture, email it to yourself, and keep a picture on your phone. Try to laminate that card, because that card is going to be very important for moving around the world, I think, in the next couple of years.
Yes, it's all very complicated moving forward. And what about herd immunity? Do you think that will kick in by the summer or by the fall?
What are your thoughts? The problem is, let's give an example of measles vaccine. We started inoculating people in the year 1963. Do you know when we got rid of measles? In the year 2000. So the problem is, a lot of the anti-vaxxers out here, and I'm meeting them every day, they don't understand that if they get sick with this, they're going to have a serious problem. And a lot of them are asymptomatic carriers who go out, the young people go to the bars, and then they come home to mom and dad and to grandma and grandpa, and they're the ones who are bringing it home and causing devastation in families. You know, I know kids who return from college, the mother was dead in a week, the father was in the ICU for a month. And that's, those are the people that we have to really be careful about. And achieving herd immunity, you really need to convince the anti-vaxxers that you're not doing it for yourself, you're doing it for mom, dad, your community, your family. And viruses mutate, and if they have nowhere to jump, then they don't mutate. And that's how you stop pandemics.
Yes, and for our viewers, we are with Dr. Peter Michalos. He is the chairman and founder of the Hamptons Health Society. He is a doctor based in Southampton. His charity has done a great work in the Hamptons, providing medical supplies to not only Stony Brook Southampton Hospital, but also to many other medical institutions in the Hamptons. And Dr. Michalos, getting back to you and your work with your charity, can you give our audience a little more information about how they can give to your organization, and exactly what you do with the funding?
Well, what we do is, we, no one gets a salary, and we use the money to purchase equipment directly. And the other thing we use the salary for is to give scholarships. We have given local boys and girls, when we had a nursing shortage a few years ago, the way we addressed it is, we know that there is no housing. So you can bring all the doctors you want, and you can build all these beautiful new buildings and cancer centers, but you need doctors and nurses for these things. So what we did was, we took the money, we had local boys and girls who have housing here, and we gave them scholarships to go to nursing school, and they got through the Stony Brook school where the tuition is reasonable. We paid their tuition, and in exchange, like the military, we asked for 3 years of service to the local community. All seven of our scholarship recipients all work at Southampton Hospital. All of them have worked at the hospital during the pandemic. So that's another place where our money goes. We also sponsor continuing medical education events. We have sponsored lectures for the community and for doctors for additional training in every specialty area so that we continue to advance knowledge. We also pay for a very advanced Mosby computerized continuing medical education and nursing education for the nurses. So when the nurses need to get their continuing education, they go into the room that they have for nursing education and training and all the CPR dummies and all those things, which we supplied over the years. All that equipment that's in there is all was purchased by the Hamptons Health Society, and they can go on the computer from home and they can do their continuous training and get certified online with those programs that the Hamptons Health Society supplies. All our philanthropy is laser targeted.
Which is really great. Now, is there a phone number that someone can call if they want to donate or get involved?
Yeah, they just call the office at 631-283-3222.
And could you repeat that once more?
631-283-3222. And they can also always mail to the Hamptons Health Society, P.O. Box 5083, Southampton, New York, 11969. That's P.O. Box 5083, Southampton, New York, 11969.
And getting back to the COVID-19 pandemic that we're in the midst of, how long do you think we'll all be wearing masks? Do you think in 2022 we'll still be wearing masks, and maybe in 2023? And can you also relate to the audience just how important it is not to get sloppy with all the precautions that our government has asked us to take, like wearing a mask, social distancing, and keeping our hands and face clean, and our body, of course.
I think if you look at what California did, what did they base their lockdowns on? They based it on the number of ICU beds. When they saw ICU beds filling up, they locked things down. And why? Because it shows and exposes the weaknesses in the healthcare system. What happened in New York was about 20 years ago, there was something called the Burger Commission. And the Burger Commission cut 1,500 ICU beds to save money in New York State. And they also cut 20,000 hospital beds, closed down some community hospitals like Long Island College Hospitals and others in Brooklyn and Queens, those hard hit areas. And they cut these hospitals to save money. And even Southampton Hospital was forced by this Burger Commission to cut hospital beds. And now we know that healthcare is national security. If we had some catastrophic event, a war, a pandemic, you know, a mass casualty event, we just don't have the capacity to do it. And that's why we had to have Comfort Ship come in, and we had to set up tents in Central Park and the Javits Center and all these things, because we really are under-equipped, and this pandemic exposed that. And in the European countries, in the socialized medicine countries, it exposes the weaknesses of these countries. That's why they lock people down, because otherwise they're going to have a row of people dying in the hallways of hospitals. And we're just not prepared. I think the real game changer is going to be when there is a pill like Tamiflu for the flu. Merck is coming out with a pill that was originally tested on ferrets, which have a similar immune system to humans, at Emory University. And Merck has taken over the project, and it might be released in the next 2 months. When we have this monovipravir called MK4882, we're going to actually have access to a pill that you're going to take for like a week, maybe twice a day, and it's going to knock down every type of RNA coronavirus and even the variants. So that's going to be tremendous, because we're seeing these variants like the California variant, which doesn't even respond to the ready-made antibodies that they gave, for example, to Chris Christie, and he did well in New Jersey. They stopped even shipping those antibodies because they showed it's ineffective, and these new variants have learned to evade antibodies. So I think having that new pill and the oral antiviral, just like AIDS, Dr. Fauci's been in charge of the AIDS program for 40 years. We still don't have a vaccine, but fortunately there was a doctor who's now at Columbia University, and he was at Cedars-Sinai, California at the time, came up with the idea of a cocktail of three antivirals, and that's how they finally controlled the AIDS pandemic. And I also think we're going to have an antiviral pill and a treatment that's also going to help us really get through this. The good news is, in history, the pandemics last about 18 months, and they usually go in three waves. I also warn people to be prepared for Passover and Easter, because that's going to be our third wave. It's not going to be as intense as the last two, but we really need to be careful, because we're going to have a third wave. The virus mutates to multiply faster and be more contagious, because it wants to live. but it burns out and eventually it learns not to be as deadly because it learns not to kill the human host, its hotel. So that's why 18 months is a good indicator of when things will turn. And also remember, in 1968, the Hong Kong flu, the same thing happened, but nobody talked about it. 100,000 people died in the United States and 1 million died worldwide. So 18 months, we're looking at June for a turnaround point.
Dr. Michalos, besides the COVID-19 pandemic and the enormous problems it's caused for our country, what other problem do we have in healthcare that we really need to solve? What's the number one disease besides COVID that we have no answers for and that needs to be solved?
Well, I think the number one disease in this country, believe it or not, is mental illness and mental health. And that's a big problem, and it's really been exacerbated by COVID. And in the basket of mental illness, I also include drug abuse, prescription and non-prescription abuse. And now we're going to start seeing certain substances are being legalized. We're going to start seeing more car accidents. It's not only going to be driving while intoxicated, we're going to have driving while stoned and other problems, which mental health access is a problem because it's not reimbursed properly by most insurance companies. Just look out here in Southampton. How many psychiatric clinics do we have? How many psychiatrists do we have who are board certified? Try to make an appointment with a psychiatrist in a small community area like this. It's very difficult to recruit them because reimbursement is lower. It's very hard to get people to cover emergency rooms, very hard to operate an office. People don't realize when I came out here, 99% of the doctors were private doctors. Now 99% of the doctors work for an institution, whether it's Northwell or Stony Brook or Meeting House Lane, or, you know, all the ophthalmologists out here were bought out by Chicago Pacific Hedge Fund, and it's called SiteMD, and everyone's consolidated because they really can't make it, and that affects access to care. So I think that's one of the biggest problems, preventive care and access to care.
Yes, and no question with this pandemic, mental health issues are greater than before. People required to stay home, and when people lose jobs and have no source of income, well, it affects almost everyone in mentally in some way or another. It's been a tough haul for sure for just about every single person in this country and in this world. And unfortunately, I agree with you, doctor, mental health issues are paramount and of great importance. And we have to work more towards helping people with issues in this area. Now, we just have a few minutes left. And one of the things I always like to ask our guests is, what advice do you give to young people just starting out in careers, just starting out in life? How can they move forward, and how can they bring those that they love forward as well?
I always tell young people that they need to have passion and persistence, and in whatever field they choose, they need to have the four A's: availability, affability, affordability, and ability. And ability I have at the end, because sometimes, for example, in medicine, patients are more interested in people's availability and their affability. And it's very important that you work very hard at whatever you do, have a passion for it. Don't think about money and finances. If you do good work, everything else will fall into place. If you help others, there's no greater joy than helping another person. You know what I did for years, making blind people see, putting people's faces back together after traumas, after Mohs surgery. It's extremely rewarding. And despite all the paperwork and the other headaches, it's still whatever they choose, just do it honorably, ethically, you know, follow the law, do good work, and things will work out for you.
And I like all of your advice. No question that when we believe in ourselves and we work hard and we're honorable, and then when we volunteer, when you give, you get. And I think it's very important for future generations to get involved in the philanthropic process by giving time, knowledge, and available resources. Dr. Michalos, thank you very much for joining us. This concludes Successful Philanthropy. I'm your host, Jean Shafiroff. I'll see you next week.